Budi. Oh, Pak Bambang, ya, Waalaikumsalam.
Wah, kolega saya ini ketemu
Iya, ini
sekarang.
lama enggak ketemu ini.
Iya, diusir dari Jogja ya.
Malah jauh, malah anu. Malah jadi pejabat. Sehat, Pak Bambang?
Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, Prof.
Pak Bambang.
Je, halo Bu.
Ketemu lagi di sini ya.
Tenun.
Oh, Bu Idna.
Kurang gengge sih, Ma.
Alhamdulillah, ketemu lagi.
Makassar.
Alhamdulillah. Ketemu
sehat,
lagi,
Bu.
Ya, sehat, ya. Alhamdulillah.
Gimana situasi sana? Sama dengan Jatim ya, masih.
Iya.
Dari pagi belum berhenti nih Pak Bambang, laptopnya webinar terus.
Bu Kapus, Tilia.
Sudah masuk, Bu?
Sudah. Good afternoon, Bu Kapus.
Belum ada. Translate. Translate. Itu ini di Indonesia, orang Indonesia itu. Tapi kan dia bahasa Inggris. Belum mulai. Jam 1.
Bu Kapus, sudah masuk ya, Pak?
Belum, Bu.
Beliau ada masalah belum bisa masuk, Pak Andi.
Baik, Bu, kita tunggu. Pak Kepala Badan juga belum, Bu ya?
Saya sudah kontak.
Ini Yongki Hartantio. Bu Kapus sudah masuk, Pak, Bu.
Oke, good afternoon, Bu Kapus.
Ya, Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Novi, Pak Direktur, dan rekan-rekan semuanya.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ini
pastinya. Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, Bu Ida.
Yeah. Apa kabar, Bu?
Alhamdulillah, fine, good. Bu Ida, baik.
Kita tinggal menunggu kepala badan, Bu Kapus.
Baik, saya juga coba ini ya, Bu Novi.
Oke. Yeah.
Saya coba sampaikan kepada beliau.
Siap, Bu.
Tadi Mbak Caca udah bantuin belum, Pak? Ini kok bapaknya belum bergeming ya?
Udah ingetin juga tadi, udah saya kasih di kuncinya. Mbak Caca
lagi coba telepon. Oh, coba. Pak Anggi coba telepon, Mbak. Ya.
Pak Kepala Badan udah masuk, Bu.
Kepala Badan sudah hadir. Good afternoon, Mr. Daddy.
Okay, good afternoon.
Okay, we can start for this seminar, sir. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon and best wishes for all of us. Selamat siang dan salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Thank God we should pray to the Almighty God because we have been given the opportunity to attend international seminar about agricultural extension 4.0. Lifelong Learning Education for Farmers. The Honorable Professor Dr. Insinyur Dedi Nur Samsi, MAGR, Head of Agricultural Extension and Human Resource Development Agency, Ministry of Agriculture, Republik Indonesia. The Honorable Professor Insinyur Budi Guntoro, SPT, MSc, PhD, IPU, Chairperson of Persepsi Indonesia. Welcome to speakers, Professor Birendra Kumar, PhD, Mr. Wahyu Sutisna, Dr. Siti Aziza, SPT, MSOS, MKOMUN, and Dr. Bambang Sudarmanto, SPT, MP. Once again, we say thanks for to the presence of Mr. and Mrs. and a happy audience. Before we start the event, let's pray according to each other's beliefs. May God make this event useful for all of us and run smoothly and conducively. Start praying. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we inform you that the number of participants is around 1,200. This seminar can be accessed by Zoom meeting and YouTube. Okay, before we start the program, I will read arrangement of the event as follows. First, the opening. Second, welcome speech. Third, presentation session and discussion. And the last closing. Ladies and gentlemen, let's open the event by reading Basmalah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Entering the next event is a welcome speech. First, greeting by Chairperson of Persepsi Indonesia for Professor Insinyur Budi Guntoro, SPT, MSc, PhD, IPU. Time is yours.
Oke, okay, thank you Ibu Ida Widya Asanti. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Oke, okay, good afternoon and everyone. Yang terhormat Bapak Kepala Badan Penyuluhan dan Pengembangan Sumber Daya Manusia, Chairman of the Extension Agency and Human Resources Development, Ministry of Agriculture, Profesor Dr. Dedi Nur Samsi, and also Direktur Politeknik Pembangunan Pertanian Malang, Dr. Bambang Sudarwanto, Resort Person, Profesor Dr. Birendra, Dr. Siti Aziza, Bapak Widya Sutisna, dan Dr. Bambang Sudarwanto, Moderator Dr. Ida Widi Arsanti, all persepsi member, participant, delegates, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Persepsi, Indonesian Society of Livestock Socioeconomists, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Director Politeknik Pembangunan Pertanian Malang and also the Chair of Persepsi Jawa Timur, ISJAVA, for inviting me institutionally to welcome speech online seminar on agriculture extension as lifelong learning education for farmers. It is great pleasure and even more an honor for me to be invited in this event. This topic is very interesting, especially for extensionists and also extension agent, since it is seldom we have even talking about these issues on the public seminar. Although extension, in fact, is very important. Moreover, the agriculture sector is demanded to improve the production while in facing challenges in the midst of global competition and advanced technology. In Indonesia, government plays an important role in agriculture development. Even when agriculture extension is farmer-led, government at whatever level must be concerned with production, the impact of agriculture practices on the environment, regulation governing quality standard, food safety, and in general, the well-being of the people. There has risen a myth about the powerless state However, it is no myth that government extension has in many cases become irrelevant and has been bypassed by non-government organization and private commercial or company extension. Though it is government that decided whether or not to become directly involved in agriculture extension. Government are facing new extension challenges, like meeting the need to provide for all, raising rural income and reducing poverty, and sustainably managing natural resources. These critical challenges exist in rapidly changing world. Globalization, new technology, the new relationship development between the public and private sector, the multidisciplinary nature of agriculture, heterogeneity between and within countries, geographic dispersion of rural people, all these realities are putting new pressure on developing countries such as Indonesia in the effort to develop. This has become our homework. Governments as well as organization, non-governmental organization, international organization need to benchmark the pros and cons of newly reformed institutional arrangement for agriculture and extension system and learn from each other. Institutional reform appear to have been successfully carried through in various countries and may be of value to government when considering the possibility of reforming their own agriculture and rural extension. However, no single reform measure can be considered a panacea. All are work in progress and depend on the commitment, resources, capacity, attitude, and motivation of the stakeholder at various levels. Through this seminar forum, congratulations. And let me finally wish you a successful online seminar and fruitful discussion. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for your speech, Mr. Prof. Budi Kuntoro. And then the next speaker is a head of Agriculture Extension and Human Resources Development Agency. Agriculture Ministry of Indonesia. And at the same time, please open this event officially for Professor Dr. Insinyur Dedi Nur Samsi, MAGR. Time is yours.
Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
The Excellencies, Professor Budi Guntoro from Persepsi, also Dr. Siti Asisah from Persepsi Indonesia. Excellencies, Professor Birendra Kumar, Dean College of Agribusiness Management, Bihar Agricultural University. Our colleague, Dr. Ida Widi Asanti, Dr. Bambang Sudarmanto, Mr. Wahyu Sutisna, and ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, let's say our gratitude to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala for the blessing and guidance given to us so that today we are still given heart to be able to attend this seminar. We welcome to all seminar's participants here. Our seminar today takes the topics agricultural extensions as lifelong learning education for farmers. This seminar, of course, is for all levels of society without exception, both those who have a community empowerment spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, education for the extension is very, very important and interesting to discuss. This seminar aims to provide provisions for anyone to expose the word of community of empowerment in agriculture. Talking about lifelong education, it is not a structured educational system, but it is a basic principle of an existing educational organization. In reality, we are experiencing lifelong education even with different methods and different processes. According to Cropley, lifelong education is a formal idea to organize education experience extended to include all different age groups, from children to adults. It means that the process of educating ourselves will continue for the rest of our life. The role of lifelong education is very important for us because we are adapting to our environment so that we will be able to live in harmony with the changing environment and society. On the other side, lifelong education provides opportunities for us to keep improving our life quality. Ladies and gentlemen, there are 5 characteristics of lifelong education learners as follows. First, he realizes to learn for the rest of his life. Second, he realizes that learning new things is a logical option to solve the problems. Third, he always has a passion to learn at all levels. Fourth, he welcomes change and has an open mind. And fifth, he believes that challenges are opportunities to learn new things. In this regard, the extension is part of lifelong education in a more practical manner. Lifelong education through extension will provide opportunities to develop agricultural better. More people who have the characteristic of lifelong education learner in the agricultural sector will be able to build sustainable agriculture and increase farmers' welfare. In terms of extension, one of our strategies is Kostratani, Komando Strategis Pembangunan Pertanian Tingkat Kecamatan. It is the revitalization of BPP, Balai Penyuluhan Pertanian or Agricultural Extension Office in sub-district level. The aims of Kostratani are to enable all agricultural extension officers in sub-district level are in the field to support farmers. To ensure all of agricultural extension officers are providing sufficient information to farmer as well as to the regency, provincial and central government. And to work hand in hand with the central government by reporting data weekly to enable the central government act with specific intervention. Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to listen presentation by the speakers. Therefore, before we start the seminar, allow me to officially open the seminar with saying Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Finally, we would like to thank all participants and hopefully we will have a fruitful discussion and provide valuable recommendation. That is all. Thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Profesor Dedi, Insinyur Dedi Nur Samsi, MAGR, for opening this event. Then enter the presentation session. This session will be guided by the Head of Center for Agriculture Education, Agriculture Ministry, for Ms. Dr. Ida Widi Arsanti, SPMP. Time is yours.
Thank you, Ibu Novita, for your handover to me. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Selamat siang, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is very pleasure to welcome all of you in this international webinar, the third series of international webinars hosted by Polbangtan Malang and also Pusdiktan, the Indonesian Agency for Agriculture Extension and Human Resource Development. I am Dr. Ida Widya Arsanti as moderator today. The topic that we would like to deliver today is agriculture extension as lifelong learning education for farmers. We are happy to have with us Professor Dedi Nur Samsi, the DG of Indonesian Agency of Agriculture Extension Ministry of Agriculture. Selamat siang, yang saya hormati Bapak Kepala Badan Penyuluhan dan Pengembangan Sumber Daya Manusia Pertanian, Profesor Dedi Nur Samsi.
Selamat siang.
I would like to welcome also the speakers, Profesor Budi Guntoro from Persepsi Indonesia, Dr. Bambang Sudarmanto, the Director of Polbangtan Malang, Profesor Birendra Kumar, the Dean of Agriculture Business Management, Bihar Agriculture University, Mr. Wayu Sutisno, Farmers Field School Consultant, and also Dr. Siti Asisa from Persepsi Indonesia. Selamat siang, good afternoon, Bapak-bapak dan Ibu-ibu para narasumber. And also I would like to welcome all of the audience in the international webinar today, including the extension workers, lecturer, practitioners, and also the students. Ladies and gentlemen, if we are talking about agriculture, we have to think also the human capital on that. Who are they, the key actors of human resource of agriculture? Yes, that's true. Farmers is the key actors, one of the key actors, and then middlemen, academics, government, and so on. But don't forget, extension workers, para penyuluh kita, play important roles in boosting agricultural productivity, increasing food security, and also improving rural livelihood, promoting agriculture as an engine of pro-poor economic growth. The extension worker should be work hard to keep update the knowledge and also know-how of the farmers, to maintain that farmers have access to improve the technology in order to increase the productivity and value added of agriculture products, agriculture commodities. This way, agriculture education and extension should be managed as long life education for farmers. It is very important for transition to sustainable. Yeah, this is a very interesting topic today. And therefore, to share the experiences, the Ministry of Agriculture of the Republic of Indonesia is inviting the stakeholder to briefly elaborate the measure that has been taken by the government through this international meeting. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first resource person, I invite Professor Birendra Kumar that would be delivered the topic of agriculture extension as lifelong learning for farmers, issued and also the experiences. Professor Kumar, time is yours.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Professor Kumar.
Namaste. Thank you very much. I like the rituals that were held in the forum. I very much like thanking God. We also do that for the success of this webinar. The topic today is the call of the times. This is the thing that we need to discuss. Very rightly said by Professor Budi, that changes are imminent everywhere. Even Professor Dedi talked about changes in society, global changes, changes in technology. Agriculture extension that we are practicing evolved in 19th century, precisely 1850, with the beginning of university extension in England. A lot of time has gone by. Almost two centuries have gone by. Agriculture extension has changed the shape. It is called education. Education has different connotations, different meaning in different culture. But one thing for sure, as you also said, education for enhancing the human capital. Education for building the human resource. In India, they say that education for banishing the ignorance, lead me from darkness to light, education that makes people capable. So ladies and gentlemen, in the perspective of lifelong learning, which is not general education, this is education for survival. People need to have skills to survive in 21st century because technologies have changed. In India itself, due to the pandemic, there was a mass migration of laborers from here to there across the country. And the government has made digital transactions very much essential. People need to learn digital finance, digital transaction. Who will teach them? Whose role is this? They are shocked, they are paralyzed if they don't have this knowledge. So on and so forth. So very right topic chosen by the Indonesian Forum, that lifelong learning and agricultural extension. I would start by quoting Alvin Toffler. Alvin Toffler is a very famous writer from USA who became suddenly famous in 1970 with his book, Future Shock. The big future shock, he was not a sociologist, he was a journalist. But he took time off and did a big research on how society is changing. And then he wrote that there is a shock in the society because the speed with which knowledge is changing, speed with which technology is changing, lifestyle is also changing. Everything is becoming disposable, including marriage and many other relationships that we have taken for granted. And he said, there is a warning. A very different kind of education is required if you want to cope with change. So ladies and gentlemen, today I have three objectives to fulfill. One, I will talk about agriculture extension, how it has changed from the public education that it came in England in 1850. Universities realized that people outside of the wall of the university need to have learning, new learning. That was the beginning of industrialization. And so they thought that people out there must have the knowledge which is brewing in the university. One. Two, in America, they realized that with growing industrialization, farmers are lagging behind. So they had rules, regulations, and the new kind of education came and they called it agricultural extension education. They had extension agents and a whole lot of infrastructure was built. When that was transported to us, Asian countries or developing nations, it became transfer of technology. That is teach and tell. Go tell the farmers, these are the technology, they are good, demonstrate to them and tell them they will do it. It did not happen. It did not happen. One way top down communication to the farmers without taking into account their social, cultural, and resource situation, it backfired. And what we had hoped, that these technologies imported from abroad, these technological combinations of fertilizer, hybrid seeds, and chemicals will do wonders. They did not do wonders in all the parts of the country. That was a shock. The scientists also received, and they said that this TOT, transfer of technology, one way transfer of information to the farmers, failed miserably. Was this an education? Yes, extension agents went to the farmers. They demonstrated. They held meetings. They told them, but they did not see whether they listened or not. Do you understand me? So this one-way communication brought many problems than they solved. I tell you the case of India. At the peak of Green Revolution in 1960s, there was a Red Revolution, bloody revolution in some parts of the country, and there was a movement of the farmers to oppose the large farmers because small and marginal farmers were not getting the benefits. So, number one, this TOT type of agricultural extension failed. And in international research organizations, they started talking about second type, farming system research. And they said that we will also consult the farmers. We'll take into account the women. So far, women farmers were not on the scene. They said that we'll also take into account some of the indigenous knowledge. Here is the wisdom. Here is the wisdom, ladies and gentlemen of agriculture extension, that knowledge also belongs to the farmer. He is not a passive listener. And when I say farmers, there are many varieties of farmers. Farmers who have very little land to do anything with, and he also has knowledge. So this recognition came. So paradigm one, transfer of technology. Tell them they will do it. Paradigm two, consult them. And we will come out with better solution. And there were movements throughout the world about different systems of education, about which I will tell later. And there came a third paradigm, a third model of agricultural extension, and that was participatory agriculture extension, of which Mr. Wahyu is a great expert, farmers, field school, and whatever. They realized that it is working with farmers, taking their knowledge, doing things as they do, that is the only way education can happen. So what I'm saying is, when we are considering lifelong education, we must see the mistakes that we have done, and have we learned from that? I heard the gentleman who welcomed and the great officer was talking that the government also has a system. Yes, the government has a system. And the man at the bottom of the pyramid, at the grassroots, he is an officer, he is an extension agent. He feels compelled to talk what the government wants to talk. I was working in Africa and I said, how is the situation in your country? How does agriculture extension work? Farmers said that we are very much oppressed. What we do is, they tell us the technologies, they give us money, a lot of money through cooperatives, and then after the harvest, they come and they force us to give the credits back. What I'm saying is, this was called by one of the great educationists, Paulo Freire, that this is manipulation of the farmer than education. So I'm very grateful to this Indonesian forum that they have brought out the term agriculture extension as lifelong education, or there is a better term, lifelong learning. So how it can become lifelong learning? If we are still oppressing them, manipulating them, telling them what we feel is good, how it can become a lifelong learning? So these issues compel me to think that there is need for another paradigm or another model of extension education, which can subsume, which can include many other things to become lifelong learning. As the gentleman who inaugurated, he said that there are youths, there are farmers, there are non-farmers, there are old people. Everybody needs to learn something to live life. You know, Alvin Toffler, whom I quoted earlier, he said that the illiterates of 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot unlearn, relearn, and learn. So that means the premium is on unlearning the unwanted things which is belonging to past now and relearning new skills, new knowledge, and this is for everybody. So this is just survival skill that we are talking about, and we have to think what kind of model of education shall we bring in extension profession, which is not manipulative, which is giving survival skills. And as Paulo Freire, you might have heard about Paulo Freire. He was a Brazilian educator. He was an adult education specialist. And he said that by telling people, you cannot teach them. And especially farmers and those who are deep in their life, why should they listen to you? So what you have to do is what Mr. Wahyu is doing. You have to listen to them first. And then listen to their cultural symbols. And then think, how can I connect with them so that they become conscious of their problems? Not giving them solution, making them conscious of their problems so they can organize the group and have action to solve them. This is where I'm hitting at, that lifelong education, for God's sake, let it not become another tool of exploitation. Another tool of saying that, hey, we have an ICT and we have e-learning and we will teach you. No, you cannot. You cannot. You cannot teach them that way. So with participatory agricultural extension, we have the new tools and techniques that organize the community on the basis of interest. Have self-help group. There, let there be community communication. I will come to that, how technologies will help in it. Community communication. Understand the cultural symbols of the people. I was very glad to see your cultural symbols. The way you greet people, the way you thank God before starting the webinar. In our country, we light the lamp symbolically and say that, lead us from darkness to light, from ignorance to wisdom. Great. These cultural symbols have to be respected. That's the only way in which true lifelong learning can start. So with this in view, let me talk about Paulo Freire, who was frustrated with this American, European way of education. He said this American or European or whatever colonial way of education is very much oppressive because it assumes people as ignorant. And it tells them think in a language in any way that it is more like a banking, right? Banking. You tell them and then you ask them to give that back in the examination. Write exactly the differences that I told you. Write the definition that I told you in the classroom. Like that, this rote learning, he said, this is the banking concept of education. And what we need is a concept of education which is making people conscious, and that requires cultural interventions. How shall we enter into the culture of the farmers and with them, together with them, organize group activities and make them conscious? I will talk about another educationist, educational philosopher, Ivan Illich. Ivan Illich was one who talked about de-schooling society. He said that the formal schools, the formal way of organizing training, where the president of the department will give inaugural lecture, and another professor will give.
Excuse me, Prof. Kumar, your voice, you can unmute.
Hello, Professor Kumar. You can unmute your voice.
Right. Is it right now?
Yes.
Is it good? Okay.
Good.
So, Paulo Freire, Ivan Illich, and then in my own country, there was an educator called Rabindranath Tagore. He was a Nobel laureate. He was a poet. He started a university. He said, I'm frustrated with what is happening in Europe because with their education, they're bringing more war than peace, more conflicts than solution. And so he said that we will have a kind of education which is holistic in nature, which is natural. So instead of building a lot of lot of towers and architectural wonders, he held classes under the trees and different types of trees which are giving shade, which are giving flowers, so that people will study under the nature. Friends, what I'm saying is education is not telling them what to do, but creating an environment in which people learn. So this gem of an educator, Rabindranath Tagore, he also ventured into agriculture extension. Around the university, Vishwabharati University that he created certain villages where people will go. And you will be surprised, since he was a Nobel laureate and he traveled to Europe, many Europeans also came to help him. And one of them, Albert Amherst, had read extension education and he said, Kobi, Guru, Guru, we call to master. Guru, you don't worry, I'll go to the village and tell them. Well, for God's sake, don't tell them anything. The first day that you go to the village, you just greet them, sit with them, eat with them, and try to understand the problem. Don't talk about agriculture anymore. They went 3 days, 4 days, and did not talk about agriculture. When they came back, the Rabindranath Tagore also came back from Europe, and he asked what happened. He said, problem is very different. They are dying of malaria. Well, good. Now you go talk about malaria, the disease due to mosquitoes. And then talk about a health group, and then you start your business. Ladies and gentlemen, what I'm telling is that Rabindranath Tagore gave us a model of agriculture extension, and he said villages have not to be developed. Villages are already developed. They had their own culture, which we killed due to colonization. In your own country also, there is a history of colonization. So all this has disturbed our creativity, and so you have to strengthen them. He called agriculture extension as rural reconstruction, something that is already there, and we have to reconstruct them in the shape. With these two things in view, changing nature of agricultural extension from transfer of technology to participation that we have learned from our colonial masters and the international scholars to different views of education, now we have to reconsider. We have new tools now. We have videos, we have ICTs, we have e-learning, and many other tools, community radio. We have to learn whether these tools can help us create a dialogue, an intervention, a people-oriented communication, so that we can think of this survival skill, lifelong learning. So in that, I will talk about 2-3 experiences, direct experiences that I have. When I was at a premier agriculture university, Pantnagar, in the Department of Communication, I had the good opportunity of starting community radio. And this community radio for me was a tool of development communication. All the masters, all my superiors told me that get recorded the speeches of the scientists, the interview of the scientists, and then play them on the radio. I said, no, this will not happen. This is a community radio. First community has to be created, the listening community. We went to different villages, involved our communication students to do the ethnographic survey, cultural survey, understanding their activities, their problems, their way of learning, their communication, everything. And then we conducted focused group discussion with each of the groups, with children. What do you want? Children said, we need to have a debate competition. We need to have a cultural programs. We need to have some information about career or whatever, whatever. Similarly with the women, and we made groups of different people who are interested to communicate. At the same time, there was an innovation. We made community journalists for the radio. People who will have their own mobile phones through which they will record and send to the studio through WhatsApp, and we will play them. What happened as a result of that, we were not getting any grant from the government for all this, but within a matter of 6 to 12 months, what happened was amazing. There were many people who were raising their voice, and they were telling that our folk songs, our folk theater should be projected there. There was a competition. Even some singers said that we will sing for you for the agricultural song without taking any fees. You just let us in. What I'm saying is, when the community came together, the radio became alive. And mind you, this was not run by workers. This was run solely by the students and the volunteers from the community. I see a hope in it. I see a hope that if we if we take community radio from the development communication point of view, from people's point of view, can this become a tool for people to learn things that they want to learn? That is what many of the beginning speaker have said. Somebody said five characteristics. It is self-directed, self-motivated. Exactly. Unless it is on the choice of the farmer, on the convenience of the farmer, the way they like it, it will be an operation than an education. So what we have to do is create a network of learners who can learn together. And they're learning from both sides. What I said about the great Indian educator, Rabindranath Tagore, he said, not only university will teach to the villages, but the culture of villages, art and craft of the villages will also come to the university. And there would be an exhibition, a fair, where both of them would be displayed so that East learns from West, West learns from East. Similarly, so both the partners become teachers and students. Unless we understand this philosophy, we cannot do any help to agriculture extension, but let it go in the mechanical way as it goes in any government hands. So I'm sure Mr. Vahyu will be talking about farmer field approach. In our country, Mr. Vahyu, we had one areca nut growers, a kind of plant which is eaten, areca nut. So organic areca nut growers, with the help of a Dutch voluntary organization, had their own organization. They collected their own knowledge. They had their own newsletters. They had their own journalist training. And they invited others, scientists, that if you want to learn, you can join in our workshops. This will be the real triumph, the real winning of lifelong education, when the scientists would be invited to the farmers' meeting to look and learn. So my point is that the medium that we have, that is community radio, is one that we found helpful. Recently, in this university that you mentioned, Bihar Agriculture University, the state government was very much ready that there should be a new roadmap and information and communication technology should be used. So what we did was we created video conferencing facilities in the university with the villages and the government training centers. And both the parties, the scientists and the farmers, sometimes the ministers and the farmers, could talk together on the video conferencing. Added with that, we created a website on which many CDs were loaded, which we produced ourselves in the local languages on the agriculture. People had a choice to choose whichever they can on the website. And there are a lot of hits from many different places. What I concluded from this is that farmers need new knowledge. They need to choose. We need to give them option. And the option would not only be of the topic, but also of the language, of the format in which it will go. Will there be music? Will there be theater? Will it go through traditional folk medium or what? Or what? To support this, we bought a big bus, which was also having camera fitted into it, and camera whose inputs could go to the studio in the university. The bus is visiting different areas. Farmers have an opportunity to see the videos, see the literature that is displayed there. There are soil testing van is there, all that. And at the same time, tell them their stories. And these stories are fed back to the studio. This two-way approach, we giving our own thing, and the farmers also telling their practices. There are many farmers who are master farmers, who are experts, who do go to the training center in Institute of the Scientist. My point is that these ICTs, let them become domesticated in our own culture, and let us try, experiment, and see how they can encourage involvement of the people, rather than become oppressive with a very refined language, with a very refined methodology. They will become a tool of oppression. So finally, what I want to tell you is that this changing paradigm of agriculture extension, the different educational theories telling us, involve them, let them design the lessons, and let us experiment with it so that there is a community consciousness. What I feel is lifelong learning, the way it is today, is very much appropriate for our agriculture extension. But it needs experimentation. Experimentation of different kind that has not happened. Students of livestock, students of agriculture extension, students of social sciences, students of sustainable development have to go to villages in the style of anthropologist. Live there, observe, find out the cultural symbols, find out the traditional folk media, and then decide an experimental way in which they can be used for lifelong learning. In my own country, you might know the hard name of Dr. M.S. Swaminathan. He was Director General in IRI also, Philippines. After retirement, he created an organization and he used ICT and e-learning for the farmers, keeping both ways open, farmers' knowledge also and the scientists' knowledge also, and a continuous dialogue. What I learned in communication is less is more and more is less, and there is a level of patience of the audience. So what I conclude is that agriculture extension must turn, as this Indonesian forum is proposing, as lifelong learning. I'm sure you have heard Commonwealth of Learning already has program of L3F, lifelong learning for farmers. COL, Commonwealth of Learning, has many projects. You can also get projects on L3F, lifelong learning for farmers. The kind of work that city is doing with the goat rearing in the school, in the slumming boarding school and others, they can get funding for making more media oriented or ICT oriented. Thank you very much. I would listen more of you than speak. I'm through. Namaste. Thank you.
So thank you, Professor Kumar, for your precise presentation. But let me highlight some of your important key points. But this is in Bahasa. Okay.
I will learn. In times to come, I will learn.
Okay.
I'm interested.
Okay. Bapak-bapak dan ibu-ibu yang saya hormati, pada presentasi yang tadi disampaikan oleh Profesor Kumar, disampaikan bahwa salah satu pendekatan yang memang harus dilakukan dalam melakukan pendidikan terhadap farmers secara long life, yang kita sebut dengan long life education for farmers, begitu ya, itu adalah dengan menerapkan participatory agriculture extension atau penyuluhan pertanian yang berbasis pada komunitas. Itu salah satu poin yang tadi disampaikan oleh Profesor Kumar. Di mana di dalam kegiatan yang sifatnya komunitas atau participatory ini harus selalu dilihat bagaimana semua kegiatan itu berasal dari kebutuhan ya yang ada di petani terutama ya. Kemudian kita juga harus memperhatikan budaya, tadi seringkali disebut budaya, kemudian juga local wisdom ya yang ada di daerah tertentu, dan kemudian juga kita memperhatikan aspek-aspek lain. Bahkan tadi Profesor Kumar juga menekankan perlu adanya simbol-simbol misalnya yang kemudian kita gunakan juga untuk merangkul masyarakat atau farmers untuk kemudian mau bersama-sama melakukan updating atau menerima inovasi teknologi. Updating knowledge atau kebutuhan untuk mendapatkan inovasi terbaru ya, atau inovasi teknologi itu merupakan suatu keharusan bagi masyarakat petani. Tadi disampaikan oleh Profesor Kumar. Jadi petani itu haus akan teknologi sebetulnya. Nah, namun bagaimana untuk mendapatkannya atau bagaimana untuk bisa mempelajarinya, kita sebagai penyuluh atau kemudian sebagai peneliti atau saintis begitu ya, tidak bisa melakukan proses diseminasi ini hanya dengan mengajar atau kemudian hanya dengan memberikan informasi begitu saja kepada petani ya. Namun juga harus melalui cara-cara yang sifatnya participatory atau partisipatif itu tadi. Nah, itu yang tadi ditekankan ya. Jadi kalau hanya mengajarkan kemudian hanya memberitahu, itu petani tidak akan mengimplementasikannya ya. Namun harus disertai dengan apa kebutuhan dari petani ya. Tadi Profesor Kuma juga memberi contoh misalnya pernah membuat community radio, jadi radio komunitas ya di India. Kemudian juga pengalaman dari Profesor Kumar di India, Afrika dan Brasil misalnya. Jadi memang pada diawali dengan bagaimana mencoba menggali informasi atau kebutuhan masyarakat. Jadi petani sebetulnya apa sih begitu. Nah, kemudian juga coba didiskusikan bagaimana caranya kita bisa mendapatkan kebutuhan tersebut, misalnya teknologi begitu ya. Kemudian juga metodenya itu harus menarik begitu ya, sesuai dengan budaya, misalnya dengan musik daerah atau kemudian dengan beberapa hal lain yang sesuai, atau wayang kulit misalnya ya seperti itu, atau kemudian juga dengan beberapa kegiatan kesenian lainnya yang kemudian itu bisa digunakan juga untuk melakukan diseminasi inovasi seperti itu. Dan tadi juga terakhir Profesor Kumar menyampaikan bahwa pendidikan kepada petani yang berkelanjutan ini adalah suatu keharusan, harus dilakukan ya. Hanya sekali lagi memang harus disesuaikan dengan kondisi di Indonesia. Komunikasi bisa dilakukan melalui IT misalnya ya. Namun IT ini juga harus kita sesuaikan. Kira-kira dengan menggunakan IT apa yang bisa dilakukan? Tentu saja tadi sekali lagi dileburkan dengan kondisi budaya masyarakat Indonesia. Apalagi kita tahu bahwa di Indonesia ini punya banyak sekali suku dan adat kebiasaan ya, yang kemudian juga punya ciri-ciri dalam kita melakukan inovasi atau diseminasi inovasi teknologi. Jadi itu mungkin sedikit yang bisa saya sarikan dari apa yang disampaikan oleh Profesor Kumar tadi. Harapannya bisa dimengerti dan kemudian juga jika nanti akan ada question and answer, pertanyaan untuk Profesor Kumar. So thank you once again to Profesor Kumar, and then I would like to move to the second presenter. The second presenter is Dr. Siti Azizah that would like to present about the digital farmers applying Hautajoji in extension. So please Bu Dr. Siti Azizah, kami persilakan.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm honored to be here with you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Sangat terhormat bisa bersama Bapak Ibu sekalian. In this presentation, I will discuss about digital farmers. Saya akan bicara tentang digital farmers. So, I'm sorry, Prof. Kumar. I have to speak in two languages. So, yeah. Okay. I will start. So we realize that in this era, there are some changes that impose all of agriculture actors to transfer our thinking, behaviors, and also how to respond to these changes. I would like to share screen my presentation. Okay, my presentation here is how to apply Hautajoji in agricultural extension. Why do we need extensions paradigm transformation? Prof. Kumar already talked about these changes. So yeah, here now we have a lot of changes in our global environment that cause changes in the objectives of our extensions. Jadi ada perubahan-perubahan dalam lingkungan global kita yang haruskan kita juga mengubah tujuan dari penyuluhan kita. So some of the changes in our global environment is just like complex issues and technology, of course, and our sustainability issue. So we have to transform a lot of things like we have to make our farmers to have self-determined learning process. And we also have to mobilize and to organize community, because these changes, these complex issues urge us to change everything. And also to involve all of stakeholders in agricultural extension or agricultural program. So I think it will be a good idea for us if we don't leave behind a vulnerable groups in this project, like a youth, woman, etc., or disability people. Jadi yang kita ubah itu harus bermacam-macam dari berbagai lapisan. Misalnya dari faktor petaninya sendiri, kita harus mengubah jalan pikiran mereka sehingga mereka mau berubah dari diri sendiri. Kemudian dari community atau dari masyarakat, kita juga harus mengubah di level masyarakat, dan juga tidak lupa melibatkan semua stakeholders atau semua pihak yang terkait. Dan akan sangat menguntungkan, akan sangat bermanfaat jika kita juga mengikutkan kelompok-kelompok yang rentan terhadap perubahan, misalnya generasi muda, kemudian penyandang disabilitas maupun perempuan. Okay. Before we go to the theory, I would like to take you to understand what is youthagogy. Youthagogy is learner-centered educational theory that's founded based on some principles. First is learner agency, self-efficacy, capability and metacognition and reflection. Jadi apa itu youthagogy? Ia adalah sebuah teori yang berdasar pada beberapa prinsip. Ya, misalnya adalah yaitu bagaimana kita memperhatikan pembelajar atau target kita, petani kita, kemudian bagaimana mereka bisa mampu dalam melaksanakan program-program mereka sendiri, dan juga tentu saja dalam prosesnya itu mereka mengetahui how to learn, they know how to learn, mereka tahu bagaimana cara mempelajari sesuatu. Dan terakhir adalah reflection, bagaimana mereka merefleksi kembali apa yang sudah mereka pelajari sebelumnya. So, now we are moving to learning transformations. In the early beginning, we used to have pedagogy that teacher-led learning. So, the teacher have a curriculum to transfer to the learners. And then Malcolm Knowles in 19th century put some new theory called andragogy. This theory talk about self-directed learning. So everyone here can share the information and share the experience. And now we are going to youthagogy, which is a learner is teacher and teacher is learner. So this continuum is important to be understood, because they have several basic concepts that affect us to transfer idea and how to get information from farmers. Jadi dalam perkembangannya, penyuluhan memiliki sebuah kontinum teori. Dari pertama adalah pedagogi, yaitu bagaimana seorang guru mentransfer atau seorang penyuluh mentransfer ilmu, kemudian beralih ke andragogi, yaitu ketika antara penyuluh dengan petani saling mentransfer ilmu dan pengalaman, dan saat ini kita berangkat ke youthagogy, di mana mereka pembelajar adalah penyuluh dan penyuluh adalah pembelajar, di mana ini bisa dikatakan sebagai sebuah teori baru yang mendasari metode pembelajaran, new method of learning in new pembelajaran baru dalam penyuluhan. So with this continuum means that the role of educators is changing. In pedagogy, learners depends on the facilitator, but in andragogy, learners start to apply the previous learning and experience. But here in Hyutagoji, learners take control of the learning process, so there are negotiations between learners and facilitators in the dissertation or in the discussion. So these rules changings, of course, have to be realized by everyone who take part in the program. Jadi Bapak Ibu sekalian, dalam pedagogi, pembelajar ini sangat tergantung kepada fasilitator. Dan dalam andragogi, pembelajar mulai mengaplikasikan kehidupannya sehari-hari dalam program. Tetapi dalam hutagogi, pembelajar sudah mulai mengambil kontrol semua yang harus dilakukan dalam program tersebut. Di akhir acara, saya akan memberikan sebuah contoh. Di akhir presentasi saya akan memberikan sebuah contoh tentang program tersebut. Okay, this one is Teach Self-Directed Learning or SSDL that shows how Hyutagoji is applied in the extensions program. So, if we see here, when the teacher contribution less and less, so the learner's contribution become a more and more active. So here the teachers less active, and the learner's contribution, the learners stay more and more active. And so this SSDL shows here, the first stage, the teacher or the extension officers is, we can call the extension officer have an authority as a coach, and then he became a motivator and then facilitator, and in Hyutagoji, he became a consultant. Jadi Bapak Ibu, kita bisa melihat di sini bahwa kontribusi dari seorang penyuluh, jika kontribusinya semakin sedikit, maka kontribusi dari pembelajar juga akan semakin banyak. Di sini kita bisa melihat bahwa seorang penyuluh ini akan berubah-ubah roles atau peranannya, mulai dari dia menjadi seorang coach, pelatih gitu ya, kemudian menjadi seorang motivator ketika sudah sampai ke tahap berikutnya, dan terakhir adalah sebagai konsultan atau konsultan bagi farmers. Jadi kita hanya berperan sebagai konsultan, bukan sebagai guru bagi mereka. Okay, this one in Hyutagoji double loop learning, and this one is andragogy learning cycle. We can see here the difference between Hyutagoji and andragogy. In andragogy is only one cycle when the farmers plan and then act and then reflect and conclude what he has in the program. But in Hyutagoji, there's additional loop called beliefs in actions. So after the farmers know the problems and then act based on the problems, so it have outcomes, the farmers then have a changes in their beliefs in action. The changes in beliefs and actions then change their reflection on their mind, so they can find another problem in the community. Jadi dalam Hyutagoji ini berbeda dengan andragogi. Jika dalam andragogi kita hanya petani hanya diminta untuk merencanakan, kemudian beraksi sampai dengan menyimpulkan apa yang dia lakukan. Tetapi di dalam Hyutagoji, kita bisa melihat bahwa apa yang mereka lakukan dan kemudian apa yang mereka hasilkan bisa mengubah beliefs in action, yaitu kepercayaan dan mindset mereka terhadap apa yang terjadi dalam komunitas mereka. Sehingga mereka akan terus-menerus memperbaiki kehidupan dalam komuniti mereka, dalam masyarakat mereka. Inilah yang kemudian disebut dengan lifelong adult learning. Jadi ini this one can enable farmers to have a lifelong learning. Okay. So if we talk about pedagogy in our era, we also talk about the web or internet that we are using right now. There are citing web we have now. In the previous era, we have a web 1.0 that's a read-only web. But right now, some of us still using this web 2.0 and 3.0, like YouTube, Facebook, that writing, and everyone can write and participate in the web. But in the future, we will have web 5.0, which is called emotional web. This web, we call it intelligent web, that can catch our emotional things, so they can predict what we are looking for in the web. I'm not talking about the technical things, because I'm not a expert in this web, but this is what we are facing right now. Bapak Ibu, jadi kita menghadapi perubahan web dari web 1.0 menjadi web 5.0. Kalau dulu web 1.0 itu hanya web yang berupa read only, jadi kita hanya membaca informasi, kemudian di web 2.0 dan 3.0 kita bisa berpartisipasi dalam akun-akun misalnya Facebook dan sebagainya, atau dalam Siri ya, atau Google Assistant. Tapi dalam web 5.0 ini sudah mulai ada beberapa kecanggihan-kecanggihan baru, di mana disebut dengan emotional web, di mana web ini bisa menangkap hal-hal yang bersifat emosional, dan kemudian mungkin bisa menangkap hal-hal yang kita butuhkan dalam kehidupan sehari-hari. Okay, this is the history of the web. So right now it gets user centric. Jadi berpusat kepada pengguna. Okay. Right now we talk about what happened in Indonesia. To see our readiness in using ICT, we can see to global NRI position of Indonesia that was taken in 2019. When we see the result of the global position, now we can see the challenges and the opportunity of Indonesian user of ICT. So NRI is Network Readiness Index that contains indices that application and impact of information and communication technology in economies around the world. So this survey measures the propensity of countries to exploit what we already use in ICT. Bapak Ibu sekalian, global NRI ini adalah bisa menunjukkan posisi Indonesia sejauh mana kita menggunakan ICT atau memanfaatkan ICT dalam kehidupan sehari-hari. The indices consist of technology, people, governance, and impact. Jadi indeks-indeks yang ada dalam NRI ini adalah teknologi, kemudian manusianya, pemerintah, dan impact. Okay, where is Indonesia? Indonesia ranks 76 out of 121 economies, 121 countries that is included in the survey. So here we can see the rank, and people pillar is the challenges in our positions, and the governance is the opportunity that we can use to increase our ability in using internet. Jadi masyarakat adalah sumber daya manusia adalah komponen yang merupakan kelemahan utama, the weakest component, kelemahan utama di dalam posisi Indonesia dalam NRI. Sedangkan pemerintahan adalah komponen yang terkuat untuk meningkatkan kemampuan kita dalam menggunakan ICT.
Bu Siti, waktunya.
Okay. So yeah, I skip this and we come to digital farmers. There's correlation between Utah Goji and distance learning extension. Okay, what should extension officers do? Jadi, apa yang harus kita lakukan sebagai seorang penyuluh? We have to equip the farmers to find the right source and ask them to go around the world. If I have time, I will show you how to take farmers to go around the world just by using Google browser. But I think the time is not enough. So yeah. Here I will show some my experience here when we want to establish sheep farming village initiation with traditional Islamic boarding school. Jadi ini ada sebuah proyek kami di mana ketika kami ingin membuat usaha domba di bersama dengan pondok pesantren di tradisional. So in the planning stage, we need learners to talk about their needs and aspiration. We have a survey with for natural resources and human resources. Jadi dalam tahap perencanaan kita mulai menggali data tentang sumber daya manusia, sumber daya alam, dan apa yang mereka inginkan. Okay. Kemudian and then in organizing. Learners synchronize human, physical, and financial resources. They establish farmer groups. They talk to boarding school members, and they talk to formal leaders and academicians. Jadi dalam organizing, dalam pengorganisasian, mereka membentuk kelompok ternak, kemudian bicara dengan berbagai macam stakeholders. Okay. Dalam actuating, they are getting skilled and starting the plan. We have indigo vera planting, and then learning how to use Excel to make feed formulation, practicing to make fermentation and designing sheep house. Kita mulai menanam indigo vera, belajar untuk membuat formulasi pakan, belajar untuk membuat kandang dan fermentasi. And then in ready to launch here, we have board, hammer, mill, and mixer. Kemudian kita buat and then we have sheep pen, and then we bought chopper. Learning about marketing, and we also talk about COVID-19, and also we observing the middle scale sheep farming and the partnership contract. So how about controlling and monitoring? We have two kinds.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Please unmute. Yeah. We have two kinds of communication here. We have personal communication and group communication. Kita punya komunikasi pribadi dan komunikasi grup. Di mana kita we have personal communication with the leaders and also with the all members of the farmers group. Jadi kita punya bicara dengan ustadznya dan juga kita bicara dengan semua membernya dalam satu WhatsApp group. Okay, the lesson run. For the learners, we have to pay attention to learning styles, personalities, needs, and interests, degrees of self-efficacy, individual characteristics, and also as a consultant, we have to find information, right information. We have to pay attention to consultant our personalities and capabilities, and ready for field engagement. And we have to also talk about tangible aspect and intangible aspect. And the last one, it is never an instant process. The projects need years to establish. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for the attention. Go back to our moderator. Thank you.
Thank you, Ibu Aziza, for your presentation. It was great. Then, and also it is very clear that Bu Aziza already mentioned that nowadays, because of these changes, it is very important to implement the new method of Utah Joji. Yeah, and we also collaborate with the technology, and Yuta Joji, and also the technology, information technology is very good to implement nowadays in this era for extension workers. So thank you for your presentation. We moving to the next presenter, Pak Dr. Bambang Sudarmanto, the director of Polbangtan Malang, that would like to bring us to understand the current condition of agriculture, particularly in this pandemic. And we would like to understand more about the situation in cultivation, in agribusiness, and also in marketing of agriculture during and also after this pandemic. So please, Pak Bambang Sudarmanto, time is yours.
Thank you, Mrs. Ida Widi Asanti. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
The Honorable Mr. Professor Dedi Nur Samsi, Head of Agriculture Extension Human Resources Development Agency, Professor Budi Guntoro, my colleague, Chairman of Persepsi, Perhimpunan Ilmuwan Sosial Ekonomi Peternakan Indonesia, the speakers, Mr. Prof. Birendra Kumar, thank you for joining us, Mrs. Dr. Sisi Asisa, and Mr. Wahyu Setiana, and all of the participants, Bapak Ibu peserta webinar yang saya hormati. Silakan Mas Andi presentasinya. Pandemic COVID-19 that struck almost all countries had an incredible impact. Agricultural commodities become one of the buffer which must survive to support a minimum of 267 million people in Indonesia. Distribution and restriction factor on human movement affect the marketing of agricultural products. Therefore, there will certainly be shift. My presentation background is the marketing orientation should be a major factor, because without a definite market, then attempt will be temporary in nature and cannot last long. Do not let business oriented only on the amounts of production. In this case, businessmen will certainly try to guarantee the availability of raw materials, smooth production process, and market certainty. Difficulties distribution, whether raw material or production, will be anticipated by the business in various ways, including online sales. Jadi Bapak Ibu sekalian, pasar menjadi pertimbangan paling utama. Oleh karena itu, apabila usahanya berorientasi pada produk, maka pasti sifatnya adalah sementara atau hanya untuk kebutuhan pokok rumah tangga tersebut. Dan cara memasarkannya pun harus menyesuaikan permintaan dan kondisi pasar itu sendiri. Ini yang akan kita bahas, manakala bagaimana kondisi sebelum pandemi COVID-19, saat pandemi COVID-19 maupun prediksi nanti setelah berakhirnya pandemi COVID-19. A little picture of the market before pandemic COVID-19. Mas Andi, slide berikutnya. Conventional marketing with the meeting of buyers and sellers still dominate in this era. it is unenable. Online marketing has been done on certain commodities and products. Marketing with various wholesaler and retailers will increase the disparity between the level of producer with the consumer level. Marketing online has been done, but still on certain product and region. Producer, mainly farmers, still sell primary products. While those carrying out post-harvest or processing activities are other parties, so that farmer do not get added value. In general, attention needs to be paid to clean lines, the function of the product written on the packaging, and market segmentation. Bapak Ibu peserta webinar, pada saat kondisi sebelum COVID-19, maka memang penjualan pertemuan antara penjual dan pembeli itu masih mendominasi. Namun demikian, ketika tata niaga yang panjang itu kemudian menyebabkan disparitas harga pada volatilitas yang besar atau disparitasnya terlalu tinggi antara produser dengan konsumernya. Penjualan secara online sudah ada, namun masih pada kalangan tertentu atau produk-produk tertentu. Kebersihan, kemudian produk fungsional masih sangat sedikit. Nanti akan kita lihat perkembangannya bagaimana COVID-19 ini. Lanjut, Mas Andi. Condition in the COVID-19 pandemic, which is still ongoing. Yeah. COVID-19 pandemic, which hit almost all countries, and in Indonesia, almost in all districts, very influential in the distribution process, including agricultural product. If it can do direct sales, meeting of buyers and sellers, then only the basic needs and so implement health protocols and strictly COVID-19. The difficulty and uncertainty distribution where product cause price fluctuation to be great, and in this COVID-19 pandemic, cause people to be more alert. So they try to find safe, nutritious, and healthy food. Because healthy orientation became the main, not just feeling, functional food in great demand. Some companies to perform physical distancing, one of the already using robots. And the process and safe production need to be done biofertilizer, biopesticides, biopreservatives, atau pengawet, ya, et cetera. Next, Mas Andi. A businessman and society will make adjustment. Later on, after COVID-19 pandemic ends, then the condition before the pandemic can still be continued. And the condition when the pandemic will be adaptive and continued. In this area, businessmen and society will carry out activities that are safe, effective, and healthy. Lanjut, Mas Andi. And the post-pandemic world fairy, but more on the adjustment of business so that sustainability can be guaranteed. To market segmentation, food production will be packaged according to the need of the community. The target market segmentation is increasingly apparent. Online product marketing will increasingly develop, and in-store areas will be more dominant. But sales of conventionally keep running. Clean lines of the process and the product itself must be considered more. And product farmers have started trying to provide added value to their products. Food is not just to create a sense of satiety, but rather on the purpose helpful. Digitization and innovation of modern technology is growing. And of course, we hope it will continue to encourage the creativity of young people. Business agent must continue to be creative for the sake of business sustainability. Bapak Ibu sekalian, pada pasca pandemi nanti diprediksikan segmentasi pasar akan lebih kuat. Jadi produk-produk sudah dituju kepada siapa dan untuk apa itu akan lebih menonjol daripada sebelum pandemi COVID-19. Pemasaran secara online terus berkembang. Meski secara konvensional, terutama di pasar-pasar lokal, masih tetap ada pertemuan antara penjual dan pembeli. Dan ini tidak bisa dipungkiri di Indonesia, masih terus berjalan. Namun demikian, faktor kesehatan. Kalau kita berbicara makanan, maka orang akan banyak berbicara mengenai makanan fungsional. Di dalam pangan itu akan ada tambahan nutrisi apa yang menyebabkan orang lebih sehat. Jadi tidak hanya untuk memenuhi kebutuhan pokok hidup, tapi lebih pada kesehatan. Kemudian tentu harapannya pangan akan lebih higienis, ramah lingkungan. Dan Bapak-Ibu sekalian, ketika berbicara petani, maka diharapkan di sini petani sudah turut memberikan nilai tambah produknya. Dan tidak bisa dipungkiri pada beberapa perusahaan seperti restoran modern, hotel, maka akan ada pembelajaran pandemi kemarin, maka bukan tidak mungkin ketika robot pun akan menjadi pelayan. Oke, lanjut Mas Andi. Bagaimana dengan pelaku penyuluh kita? Seperti tadi disampaikan Prof. Hendra dan Dr. Aziza, kami melihat sisi lain ketika pada pemasaran. The condition that I said earlier, of course, it must be anticipated by agriculture extension workers as agent of change in society. In this case, the small farmers. Each region has its own advantage, including different culture and agro ecosystems. Head farmer finds and establish cooperation with various parties. Our farmers are progressing So agriculture extension workers must continue to improve their competency. Farmer cooperation became a solution. This is to increase the production capacity and bargaining value of the product. Jadi Bapak Ibu sekalian, seperti juga disampaikan oleh narasumber sebelumnya, penyuluh pertanian harus bisa beradaptasi dan terus mengupdate diri, ya. Karena ini harus menyesuaikan dengan kebutuhan petani dan juga perkembangan zaman. Penyuluh harus memiliki wawasan luas dengan narasumber sekarang tidak harus person to person, tapi bisa menggunakan web, bisa menggunakan internet, dan juga tadi dari Dr. Asisah, bahkan kita sudah berbicara pada emotional web gitu ya Bu ya. Nah itu nanti adalah perkembangan yang luar biasa, bahkan ketika tadi pembelajaran juga berkembang seperti yang disampaikan oleh narasumber sebelumnya. Dan harapannya adalah bagaimana supaya penyuluh mendorong generasi muda kita untuk mau terjun ke bidang pertanian. Karena siapa lagi yang akan menggantikan nenek moyang kita terjun di bidang pertanian. Tentu peningkatan kapasitas dan dari petani ya perlu terus didorong oleh penyuluh pertanian. That's what I want to present. Thank you for your kind attention. I hope we stay healthy. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Pak Bambang Sudarmanto, the Director of Polbank Tan Malang, for your precise presentation. Stay healthy for everyone, ya Pak Bambang, ya. Interesting that you mentioned about after the COVID-19 pandemic, the online marketing, for example, of the agriculture is getting bigger, and also the marketing segmentation, the use of technology, the healthy food, is the new preferences of the consumer. So that's why in this kind of direction, the agriculture extension should be changed also, that try to use the technology and then try to elaborate all of the stakeholders, including the young, the youth people to working also in agriculture. So thank you, Pak Bambang, once again. So for the last presenter, we still have Pak Wahyu Sutisna, yeah. Pak Wahyu Sutisna that would like to talk about the formulation and practical concept of the extension, the field school as a model of agricultural extension. So please, Pak Wahyu Sutisna, time is yours. Pak Wahyu. Pak Wahyu Sutisna, are you still following us?
He has to unmute. Mr. Wahyu Sutisna, please unmute.
Yes.
Pak Wahyu, could you please unmute your voice?
Do you listen me now?
Yes.
Okay, that's good.
Okay, thank you. So sorry, because there is voice behind me. My residence is near to open road, so vehicle is moving everywhere. Hope it is not disturbing you.
Okay.
So before going forward, I would like to express my feeling, my gladness and happiness, because today I'm around between really expert from national and international arena. Hope Dr. Birendra Kumar still around with us. So let me say that this is my first webinar, actually, invited by Ibu Aziza. Actually, thank you, Ibu Aziza, by introducing me to this valuable event. So welcome. I'm interesting to be part of this webinar. Then I was reading the title of the webinar. It is Agricultural Extension as Lifelong Learning Education for Farmer. Then I would like to share my experience how the farmer of the school will be working as the extension and then utilize for moving forward of the farmers. Ladies and gentlemen, before going into presentation, I would like to divide it into three sections. It's my presentation within the 15 minutes. Hopefully it will be sufficient time. I would like to express my experience. I am being former extension, actually. It's a long time ago. It's a long time ago. You see? Then, at the time, the problem with the farmer is at national level with brown plant hopper or orang batang coklat. So why I'm telling you this story, because I would like to come step from early up to now, what is the evolution of the farmer of his school. So being the new extensionist, and then proud to be extensionist, and then living in the rural extension center, BPP at the time, the name of BPP at the time, actually I was engaged with the extension every day because my colleagues all are extensionists. Then I'm part of the plant protection that will be integrated into the extension. Anytime there is extension call me to talk with the farmer about the how to control brown plant hopper, I will be there proudly. Then with my knowledge, with my spirit, and then I stand up in the big gathering of the farmers. You see, when collecting the farmers in the front of the field who are infected by brown plant hopper, I will be standing up there and then talking farmer, doing this one. And then farmer were coming with the, just moving their head, yes. Sometimes they are really feel astonishing with me, but I'm no bother with them than going to talk about how to control it. Astonishingly, when coming into next week, coming back to the field again, I saw there is nothing happening in the field. The field still affecting by brown plant hoppers. And then collecting again the farmers. And then again talking about how to control. If not control, you will be lost your yield, you will be lost your money, you will be lost your paddy. Some are reposting very positive, but some was responding is not positive. Then I come to my question. What's wrong with them or what's wrong with us? Because being extensionist at the time, I have to be listened by farmers. So I would like to refer to Dr. Professor Kumar. Yes, that is my experience too. It's like this one. And then I come to closely with the farmers the following time to talk about really from personal point, your point, what's wrong with the farmer actually, and either what's wrong with us, then farmer will be talking slowly to us, sir, I know you are extension agents. We know you are educated. We know you are a government officer, so I have to listen. But do you know us? I'm not really talking about brown plant hopper, even to think about how I feed my tomorrow family. It could be eating. So that's one, you see. So I'm at the time I'm talking about technology, but this time farmer, I'm not dealing about technology, but I'm thinking how I can feed by tomorrow. So that is a problem actually for us. There's also a problem for the farmers. This is referred to what the Professor Berindra say, then we come with the basket full of our knowledge to the farmer, but at the same time farmer might not see us as something very useful for them. So both sides could be joining. Where's the connected idea from us, and then what is the farmer in their head to be accommodated? At the time, the integrated pest management, you already know about this one, about IPM, was introduced in late 1989. I'm talking about slightly about the past situation. Then farmer field school was introduced by the FAO, who are assisting Indonesia to formulate the integrated pest management. But actually, it's not really the idea coming from both sides. The idea is just coming from many sources about extension. So at the time, 10 of the senior plant protection, assisted by 2 of senior FAO consultant, talking about the farmer education, actually. In the beginning, it's not field school, but farmer education. What the name of proper education properly should be introduced. Then some of our colleagues thinking, but maybe advanced training, maybe training and demonstration. So a lot of debating, a lot of idea to be compiled, and then we are going into many sources then formulate the correct name for the educational basis for the farmer in the integrated pest management site. Then come into the perfect name, Farmer Field School, which is actually reflect into learning and education of the farmers. So that's why the learning education as the extension now we are talking about in this webinar, it could be actually the soul of the Farmer Field School too. So thank you for the selecting that this webinar, the title webinar today is Puajiza. So what actually Farmer Field School is, so please show us the first presentation. Is it the second? But I need the first PowerPoint. It's all about Farmer Field School. Not this one. There's 2 presentation. This is the example.
PPT satunya Pak Andi.
I sent 2. That one. Yes, that's correct. So, what is the Farmer Field School about? This is about educational processes and result-driven under which people with common interests learning through hands-on and practical in the field. So this is the actually what I will to say definition probably is yes? Definition of the Farmer Field School. But it's about educational, it's about the result-driven activities, it's about learning, it's about the common interest, it is about the hands-on and practical in the field. So both all of things will be formulated into general activity that we call Farmer Field School. So school without wall. So remember that this team was actually enacted to by late Pak Salman Parbanagara. This one. So this is a Farmer Field School. It's reflect into education, reflect into learning, which is given to the farmer to identify the technology, to discover the technology, or to validate the technology. So both all will be tested in the field at the same interest by farmer through hands-on and practical in the field. So this one actually we call both Farmer Field School. But I'm wondering now whether the new millennial generation still remember or maybe still practicing farmer school or not, because it is quite long time ago. And then this is born in Indonesia, but extend to many other countries, and then for the world now is more than 90 countries practicing farmer school for different purposes, even in Indonesia now, it's not only in the agriculture sector, but this is moving forward. This is moving beyond the agriculture purposes. Now, it's going to be used for health and hygiene aspect. This is practicing near to Malang. This is practicing in Pasuruan for health and hygiene, actually. This is about the Farmer Field School. The second presentation, please. What is the component in the Farmer Field School?
Okay, baik. Terima kasih.
Yes.
Nah, silakan, Pak. Mungkin bisa cepat sedikit, Pak Sutisna, Pak Wahyu.
Yes, number two. Yes, this one. Field school, major learning component. There is will be learning component in the school. The name of the school would be learning in the majority. So for the field school, the field should be with live specimen, the subject matter to be learned by participants. So group the farmer will be coming into the field and then learning about subject matter to be learned in the field, either for agriculture, for fisheries, for livestock. That should be live specimen. So learning will not request in the classroom, but classroom will be moving into the field and then learning take place in the field with the common interest for specific issue. Either will be in the agriculture too will be different. Either for agroforestry, for food crop, whatever the farmer have been in interest. Being school, it should be curriculum. There is no school without curriculum. So it will be curriculum. If there is no curriculum, it could be course. Sometimes course also with curriculum, but what field school should be need-based curriculum. So curriculum should be defined by locally need. When we are talking about agroforestry, if farmer is agroforestry, then the curriculum will be surrounding agroforestry. And then the other component should be set with regular meeting. Being school, we are now, there is time regular session to the school. In the field school, it's similar. It could be in the weekly basis or bi-weekly basis or fortnightly basis. There will be the meeting. Farmer who are receive interest in the group, coming to the field, talking based on the curriculum, and then have the regular meeting based on the group decision will be in the weekly basis, bi-weekly basis, or fortnightly basis, which depend on. And every meeting should be clear agenda and time frame. So what is today meeting will be discussed, will be talking about, is depend on the field situation. And then time frame should be clear before going, before taking place, meeting taking place. Say, today we'll be meeting from 7 to 12 or maybe from 8 to 1 o'clock. It's depend on the group decision. And then there will be field observation or investigation. So during the meeting, there will be field observation, whatever they need in the field, taking note, and then presentation, and then will be set of the discussion. It will be in the field. So when this comes from the field and back into the field, and they send a set of observation. So remember that without observation, it is only talking about. It's not the field school anymore. Then, should be inserting also in during the meeting, so how they will be strengthen social cohesiveness among the group member. So the group will be coming from different background, from different education level, from different behavior, from different social status. It could be blend into cohesiveness. So there is no person dominate the others. It will be equal and sharing in the group. Then school need material as well as the school in the normal situation need material and teaching aid. So what is the material? It could be for practicing the field. If we're talking about if the field school will be taking place for agriculture, maybe for food crop, it will be what's the material do they need to demonstrate the healthy crop, say fertilizer, irrigation, whatever they need, it should be in the field school. Without this one, we cannot talk about the field school. And then the important thing is also the school should be monitored by all. It's not by determined by facilitator itself. It should be monitored whether it will be fruitful or maybe lack of the technical aspect or maybe too many technical aspect will be participatorily monitored and evaluated by all together. So it's not by the facilitator. Then the last, and it's very important, we have to be heavy competent facilitator. So because the facilitator will be responsible from the planning into the end of the whole cycle, they should be technically competent. Otherwise, the field school will be missed into the other direction. Say, we are talking about, say, healthy crop, but when the facilitator is not really competent into how good agriculture practice is, it will be leading into the other way, then it will be jeopardizing the farmer learning. So in the end, will be wrong conclusion made by farmers. So that's why we need the really technically competent facilitator. So hopefully, the extension now that the young generation will be competent in both social and physical aspects. So this is the premise of the farmer free school actually. And now I would like to present about the picture, the presentation with the picture. Please send us the other presentation back and forth. The with Kayot. Picture, yes, that one. Go ahead with the number one. So anybody knows Kayot, okay? This one, Kayot or Sahium edul. The scientific name is Sahium edul. This is Kayot. This is neglected crop that will be creeping everywhere on the ground, sometimes climbing into the tree. Nobody will taking care, but some of them are us always, sometimes also eat it as the vegetable. I think now in East Java, especially in Malang, they call it gondes. In West Java, they call labu siam. This is kayot, actually. It's for them, for the farmer, there is no value, actually. No value, because everyone can take it. This is nothing should be considered as the useful for everything, especially for soil conservation. Then now, I would like to bring all things into the farmer, how they look into different perspective about the kayot. It's not only creeping crops that can be climbing everywhere, but if they put attention, it will be more advantage or more benefit can be given to the farmers. So going down, please. The next slide. The next slide. Yes, this one, maybe. Okay. So, kayot is edible vegetable. Is it grow? Okay. The next one. Someone standing below that one. This depend by market. Leaves spreading over the right when the kayot was organized in such manner by giving the rack of the bamboo and then let the living over the rack, it will be like this one. So what is the benefit of the kayot? This is one of the example for field school. Field school, we're talking about the soil conservation, but giving them the terracing, especially in Batu area in East Java, farmer will not listen it. So you come to Sumber Berantas, let me see how many farmers are practicing terracing. No, there is no farmer practicing. He's just making a bed, so like following the contours. And then when the rain is coming, it will be flushing by runoff. The soils become poor, the soils become soil solids become thin, and then it need more fertilizer every year. So this is example how the field school can move the issue from unfallible to become fallible, because this one. So the second one is, we know the climate change was affecting all things. The climate change now changing the pattern of the rainy season. The rain, it can become heavy with certain period, but the drought will be longer time. When the rain is short, but the scale is heavier, then it could be imagined, could be run of water become flood everywhere. At the same time, this less water will be infiltrated into soil, because it's moving fast. When the run of bigger, it's moving very fast. There's no water can be slowing down and then moving into soil. So what is the action, or what is the thinking about the how we can utilize this water in for the spring protection or spring conservation? The spring water will be usable also for the farmer. Sometimes farmer is depend on the spring. It's not coming from irrigation actually in many places. So how to recharge is quite difficult. But one again, the facilitator should be really innovative. How utilize the run of water for recharging area, and then let the water through the process coming down into spring, and then irrigate the agriculture. This reduce flood and maintain sprays. Okay, go ahead. Now, this one, this is the construction. So farmer can learn how to make construction, farmer can learn how about the hydrogeology, and then farmer can learn how about maintain spring. So this is for training. But one thing again, the training now it should be connected with the climate change, because the issue now is climate change. One of the climate change aspect is the heavy rain with the short period that will be causing the big flood. This could be how farmer can learn it. It depends on the how the facilitator can lead them. This is also we are practicing in Batu. So you can come to Batu to see what is the actual field school are going there. Please, the next. Next, this one.
Bisa agak dipercepat, Pak Wahyu.
Okay. This is
cukup.
We are talking about field school, about layer, egg layer. So the climate change will be affecting also the livestock aspect, mostly of the layer, will be drop syndrome production because of the high temperature or rising up the temperature, and then wind blow. So chicken will be much more drinking rather than eating. Don't they lose energy? When it lost their energy, there will be insufficient eggs will be produced. So how we move down this one to mix the really adaptable chicken seeds into the changing of the climate at locally. So this one we introduce, you see the up, the photo in upstream, and the up, upper part, this is the traditional way where the rope is very short and then almost close into the chicken sheds. Then in the daytime, it will be increased the temperature, then more chicken will be taking more water than feed. But in the down part, we modify the chicken house, it the higher roof, then the better aeration, then also following the wind direction, and there will be improved the appetites and the maintain the fertility. This actually the such type of the field school was practicing from different perspective in agriculture sector, in the water hydrology sector, in the poultry sector. So this is some type of the how can we implement the concept in the practical manner for field school. So hopefully it will be enrich our idea on how field school will be deal with the lifelong learning and education processes as the extension tools for the farmer behavior transformation. Actually, it's not the technology transfer, but behavior transformation. So that could be my part of the webinar today, and the formulation and then practicing farmer physical at the community level. Thank you very much. And then I would be very happy to entertain if there is a question. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you Pak Wahyu Sutisna for your presentation. Bapak-bapak dan ibu-ibu semuanya, tadi sudah dijelaskan dari Pak Wahyu Sutisna bahwa memang sekolah lapang ini sangat penting ya dan sangat bagus.
Yes.
Sebagai salah satu metode untuk kemudian bisa melakukan diseminasi teknologi. Jadi
betul.
Harus menggunakan praktek begitu ya Pak Wahyu ya.
Betul.
Dan ini sudah terbukti dalam berbagai contoh tadi yang disampaikan oleh Pak Wahyu dalam manajemen water ya, jadi
yes.
Terkait dengan mencoba untuk membuat irigasi atau kemudian manajemen air tadi ya di Labu Siam dan kemudian juga di peternakan itu memang harus dilakukan sekolah lapang begitu ya, sehingga para petani ini bisa dengan mudah menangkap apa yang menjadi esensi. Dan tadi juga Bapak tekankan bahwa ini tidak hanya teknologi transfer tapi juga perilaku ya, transfer perilaku ya Pak ya, yang di sini yang memang ditekankan. Dan kemudian juga tadi disampaikan di dalam sekolah lapang ini juga harus ada beberapa hal yang penting, misalnya kurikulum, kemudian ada pertemuan yang rutin, kemudian juga fasilitator yang bagus juga ya Pak, untuk kemudian bisa membuat sekolah lapang ini berjalan dengan baik. Baik, terima kasih Pak Wahyu.
Sama-sama.
Yeah. So all of the presenters already present their topic, and now we are coming to the polling session. Ya, yeah. Jadi Bapak-bapak dan ibu-ibu semuanya, sebelum kita menginjak pada acara diskusi, kita akan sampai pada sesi polling. Nah, namun sebelumnya saya ingin membacakan sepintas ya beberapa kurikulum vitae dari para pembicara sebelumnya. Pak, ini adalah konsultan dari Food Agriculture Organization. Kemudian Pak Bambang Sudarmanto saat ini sebagai Direktur Polbangtan Malang, dan beliau ini S2 dan S3 di Gajah Mada University di bidang agrikultur. Bu Siti Azizah adalah dosen atau associate professor dari Gajah Mada, dari mohon maaf Bu, Brawijaya University ya, dan kemudian beliau juga menempuh pendidikan di Universitas Brawijaya, Animal Production, Faculty of Animal Science, S3, kemudian S2-nya juga di Brawijaya University, Development Sociology,
Master of Program of Agriculture Faculty. Dan ada beberapa buku yang menarik dari Bu Siti Asisah, ya, yaitu terkait dengan manual Guide for Agriculture Extension Officer. Mungkin nanti bisa kita cari bersama-sama. Ini sudah terbit di umum ya Bu, UB Press 2010. Kemudian juga ada aspek kehidupan petani gurem yang tentu saja juga bisa kita baca bersama. And then Profesor Kumar is currently a scholar at Dr. RPCAU Pusat. Dan Profesor Kumar ini merupakan profesor dan direktur di divisi komunikasi, ya, co-coordinator education technology, kemudian juga sebagai dekan dari College of Agriculture Business of Management. Kemudian Profesor Kumar ini juga mengembangkan establish the communication center, pusat komunikasi di Sabor pada tahun 2012 untuk enhancing quality of learning besides organizing national and university level seminar training workshop on improvement of agriculture education, summer school, and also short course on communication and education terms continuously. Jadi itu tadi sepintas biodata dari para presenter. Dan selanjutnya kami persilahkan kepada panitia untuk bisa menayangkan polling, mungkin silahkan. Sebelum kita nanti akan menginjak for the discussion session.
Thank you to Mrs. Dida Widya Santi. Next we come into polling session. This session is aimed to find out the extension, agricultural extension in the time of pandemic COVID-19. So to all participants, we hope from you all to fill our poll about agricultural extension in pandemic COVID-19. It only takes 5 minutes, so you can directly fill the poll from your Zoom screen. We can start now from the poll. The first question is agricultural extension media conducted during the COVID-19 pandemic or media penyuluhan pertanian yang cocok untuk diterapkan saat ini saat pandemi COVID-19. Pertanyaan kedua, the second question, agricultural extension methods carry out during the COVID-19 pandemic, jadi metode penyuluhan pertanian yang cocok dilakukan saat pandemi COVID-19 seperti saat ini. Kemudian pertanyaan ketiga, the third question. The third question is about agricultural extension material that is often delivered at the time of COVID-19. Jadi materi penyuluhan yang cocok untuk diberikan pada saat pandemi COVID-19. Jadi kami mohon kepada seluruh partisipan di dalam webinar internasional ini untuk mengisi polling kami tentang kegiatan penyuluhan pertanian di era atau di masa pandemi COVID-19 saat ini. It's still 21% from the participant that have filled our poll. Baru 23% dari partisipan yang sudah mengisi poll untuk partisipan yang belum mengisi poll, kami mohon kesediaannya untuk mengisi polling kami. Baru 30%. Untuk waktunya 2 menit lagi. 2 minutes left. One minute left, waktu tinggal 1 menit lagi. Waktu untuk polling session sudah selesai. Terima kasih untuk partisipasinya. Untuk hasil nanti akan kami share.
Thank you very much, Lily, for the polling session. Now, a time for discussion. I would like to open the opportunity for 3 questions, yeah, for the audience or participant that would like to ask directly to the presenters. Yeah, maybe you can raise your hand, and Bu Novi, maybe you can also help me to notice the audience or participant that would like to asking question directly to the presenter. Before, maybe I also would like to read some of the question that already written in the room chat. Are there anybody who would like to ask directly?
Yes, I think the first chat from the Bu Ajeng.
Bu Ajeng, yeah.
Yes, Bu Ajeng. Okay. Yes, write the question for Mr. Komar, I think. Yes, this is about the.
Do you want to ask directly to Professor Kumar, yeah? To Professor.
Yes. Bu Ajeng, you still there?
Professor Kumar just contact me that he lost signal, but I think I don't know is he here or not.
Oh, I see.
He's right. He's here.
Okay. Okay. The question from Ms. Ajeng about Mr. Kumar said that one-way communication could brought a problem. So what is the best solution to help our farmers so that they can brave to learn a new things?
Okay, baik. Karena Mr. Kumar tidak ada di sini,
Sepertinya kita bisa berbahasa Indonesia ya, Bu Novi.
Oh gitu, iya, iya, iya. Oh,
I think he is here.
Yeah.
Oh,
he is here.
Mr. Komar, you still there?
Can see the participants. His name is still here.
Hello, Mr. Kumar, are you there? Are you still following us?
Mr. Kumar? How, Bu Siti Aziza, Mr. Kumar still there or not?
Yes, you can see the participants. I typed his name and he's still here. But I think he has a problem with the signal.
Oh, yes, maybe.
Okay, maybe we are waiting for Mr. Kumar. Untuk bapak-bapak dan ibu-ibu, jika ada pertanyaan langsung ya yang ingin disampaikan secara langsung, mungkin bisa tunjuk tangan. Silakan, kami persilakan untuk disampaikan kepada para presenter.
Mrs. Langgeng, Mr. Langgeng.
Mr. Langgeng, silakan, Mr. Langgeng.
Oke, okay, thank you. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam spesial buat Ibu Hajah Novi. Langgeng Ibu Trenggalek. Terima kasih.
Masih ingat.
Saya akan, pertanyaan saya dan sekaligus masukan.
Alumni lupa aku.
Saya sampaikan ke Ibu Aziza sama Bapak yang, Bapak Sudarmanto. Dan Bapak satu lagi
Pak Wahyu.
Begini, di masa sekarang ini kan adaptasi baru dalam pandemi COVID-19, dalam masa adaptasi baru pandemi COVID-19, saya rasa ini istilahnya adaptasi baru dalam penyuluhan pertanian, khususnya perlu adanya kajian atau semacam riset model penyuluhan bagaimana yang paling efektif dan efisien. Itu di ini masukan mungkin dari kalangan akademisi untuk melakukan riset. Terus kepada Ibu, spesial kepada Ibu Aziza, kira-kira leaning transformasi model apa yang paling efektif dan efisien selama pandemi COVID ini? Terima kasih.
Baik, terima kasih Pak Langgeng. Tadi ada pertanyaan spesial ya Bu ya. Mungkin lanjut dulu untuk dua penanya yang lain, saya berikan kesempatan. Bisa apa? Tunjuk jari.
Raise hand, yes.
Jika ada yang ingin bertanya. Oke, sambil menunggu, saya ingin juga membacakan, ini ada beberapa pertanyaan ya di chat room. Di sini untuk Ibu Dr. Azizah, mohon penjelasan untuk contoh strategi apa yang harus dilakukan penyuluh ketika menggunakan pendekatan Huta Joji dengan sasaran vulnerable groups, namun juga termasuk golongan laggards. Nah, itu Bu ya. Nah, kemudian ini juga dari Pak Satlika. I'm interested in one of the principle of Huta Joji, which is the self-efficacy. How to implementation this approach in consulting or training for farmers? Itu untuk Bu Aziza juga ya, Bu.
Oke. Okay.
Kemudian ada how to become an agricultural extension. Oh, enggak, ini yang dari Bu Aziza, mohon maaf. Kemudian untuk Pak Bambang Sudarmanto, Pak Direktur, how about the efficiency of marketing of agriculture products since the online marketing become widespread in COVID-19 pandemic? Ini dari Ibu Tri Praja Wahyudo. Kemudian Pak Heri Bahrisal Tanjung ini juga menyampaikan, agree, lot of expectation are imposed on extension workers in order to increase the capacity of farmers. But extension institutions have not provided good infrastructure support so that the implementation of activities is not optimal. Mungkin ini bisa ke Pak Wahyu Sutisna mungkin ya pertanyaannya. Oke. Okay. Monggo silahkan dijawab. First Bu Siti Asisah, there are some question for you, and then Pak Bambang Sudarmanto and also Pak Wahyu Sutisna. And also we are waiting for Profesor Kumar to join with us again to answer some of the question. Silahkan Bu.
Okay, I think this three question is closely related. They are talking about how to apply heutagogy in agricultural extension. So, yeah, saya akan menjawab dalam dua bahasa ya. Yang pertama, bagaimana mengaplikasikan heutagogy dalam agricultural extensions. Ya, jadi untuk mengaplikasikan heutagogy, tentu saja kita harus berangkat dari kepentingan dari sasaran. Ya, jadi dari sasaran. Berbeda dengan pembelajaran yang terdahulu bahwa heutagogy ini harus sangat partisipatif. Jadi sesuai dengan apa yang dikatakan oleh Pak Wahyu Sutisna, kemudian dengan Prof. Kumar, hanya saja dalam heutagogy ini sangat membutuhkan partisipasi dalam menggunakan internet. Jadi partisipasi mereka adalah membuat mereka agar bisa mempelajari hal-hal yang mereka butuhkan langsung dari internet. Oleh karena itu tadi saya sempat melakukan beberapa hal yang belum sempat saya presentasikan. Ini boleh ya Bu Ida ya, saya presentasikan lagi.
Ya silakan.
Ya. Okay. Jadi saya ingin mempresentasikan salah satu contoh bagaimana kita bisa ya bagaimana bisa mengaplikasikan heutagogy dalam bentar. Sebetulnya ini adalah sesuatu yang sangat mudah. Yang pertama, how to make farmers find the right source. Jadi kita tidak harus selalu mengajari mereka untuk mencari apa, tapi kita bisa melepas mereka untuk mencari yang mereka butuhkan. So we ask them to go to the browsers. Ya, kita bisa mengajak mereka untuk menuju browsers. Dan mencari apa yang mereka butuhkan. Contohnya kalau mereka mencari bagaimana cara memelihara sapi ya. For example, we ask farmers farmers wants to know about the how to raise cattle. So agar mereka tahu bahwa sumber yang mereka dapat itu benar, maka kita perlu mengajari mereka untuk menemukan sumber yang tepat. Jadi we can teach them, we can ask them to find the right source. For example, memelihara sapi potong. Ya, if we type memelihara sapi potong, kalau kita mengetik memelihara sapi potong, itu bisa hasilnya kemana-mana. So, kita harus memberikan tambahan kalimat atau tambahan kata yang bisa mengarahkan mereka pada sumber yang tepat. Ya, so contohnya kita menulis kementan. Dengan ini maka mereka akan menemukan hal-hal atau sumber-sumber yang benar. Okay, this is how we ask farmers to go to the right source. Put some additional words like agricultural ministry, so they directly go to the agricultural ministry, not to the students' web. That's not trusted. Okay. Yang kedua adalah mengajak mereka untuk berkeliling dunia, ya berkeliling dunia dengan internet. So, we can teach them to go around the world with internet. Just like if we want to see how to raise cattle in China. Ya. Jadi misalnya kita farmers atau petani menginginkan untuk melihat bagaimana sih cara pemeliharaan sapi potong di Cina. So, we can use translate tools in Google. Like this, memelihara sapi potong or raising a cattle. We copy this. Okay. And go to translate. Raising a cattle. We want to know how is raising a cattle in China? Okay. Okay, we copy. So we have a lot of information here, like this. This is in China, but we also can translate. Where is the translation? We also can translate this page in Indonesian. So actually, with this internet, farmers can go everywhere, can get everywhere around the world just by clicking just few clicking, and then he can get information around the world. So, okay, this is how to apply andragogy, how to apply andragogy in web. Okay. Okay, and for the second question, how to include vulnerable groups that which include in laggards, yeah. Bagaimana melibatkan kelompok-kelompok vulnerable atau kelompok-kelompok yang rentan terhadap perubahan yang biasanya merupakan laggard, ya. Perlu kita ketahui bahwa kelompok-kelompok yang rentan terhadap perubahan itu belum pasti mereka laggard. Dan kita harus mengacu pada teori dari Cheese Lewis yang baru bahwa laggards itu sebetulnya adalah sebuah kelompok yang belum tentu mereka itu bodoh ya maksudnya. Artinya mereka itu belum tentu tidak menerima inovasi karena mereka bodoh ya. For information, laggards is not a kind of group that cannot get the information because or they do not adopt an innovation because they are stupid or lack of mentally challenged maybe ya. Jadi mereka bukan tidak menerima inovasi itu bukan karena bodoh ya, tapi kadang-kadang laggards itu adalah orang-orang yang memang lebih pintar dan lebih lebih bijak dalam menerima sebuah inovasi. Jadi mereka tidak selalu tidak menerima itu karena mereka tidak mampu gitu ya, tapi mereka lebih berpikir lebih jauh ke depan. So, should I translate in English? Yeah. So in this question, I want to inform you. I want to answer that laggards that quoted by Rogers and Shoemaker in his research. Yeah, their research. The laggards is not always. There's not always allergic to the innovation, but sometimes they are so smart. So they don't want to ruin their environment because new technology. Jadi bagaimana cara menghadapi vulnerable people dalam mengikutkan mereka dalam penyuluhan, yaitu dengan tentu saja tetap sama ya, dengan menanyakan apa kebutuhan mereka, apa keinginan mereka dalam program-program pemerintah. Mereka ingin dilibatkan dalam hal apa, dan kemudian tentu saja kita melihat apa kemampuan apa yang mereka miliki untuk bisa dimanfaatkan agar mereka terlibat dalam program penyuluhan tersebut. So that's my answer.
Okay, thank you, Asisa. I think it's answer the question of the participant, yeah, and satisfy. Okay, next. Pak Bambang Sudarmanto, silahkan. Selain tadi ada pertanyaan from the audience, there's also question from Pak Triwahyudi. He asked about the loose generation and young people are least interested in agriculture. How are the strategies and model to solve these problems? Okay, please Pak Bambang.
Thank you, Bu Ida. Pertanyaan pertama tadi dari Mas Langgeng ya, terkait dengan bagaimana supaya penyuluhan efektif dan efisien manakala pada kondisi COVID-19 ini. Tentu ini akan variasi sekali pada beberapa daerah, namun pada umumnya adalah penyuluhan dilakukan secara online. Karena ketika pandemik itu seperti wilayah merah begitu ya, kita tidak berani tatap muka langsung ya, maka harus kita lakukan secara online. Gimana ketika kemudian penyuluhan itu terkait dengan skill, terkait dengan keterampilan, maka tentu di situ penyuluh harus berkreasi bagaimana supaya terlihat membuat apakah itu vlog atau YouTube begitu ya, sehingga keterampilannya akan terlihat nyata. Namun demikian, ketika kondisinya, katakanlah kalau sekarang ada orange, ada kuning gitu ya, tentu bisa secara bertatap muka langsung dengan jumlah yang terbatas, namun protokol kesehatan COVID-19 harus dilakukan. Berikutnya, thank you for the question from Tri Praja Wahyudo. Efficient marketing which include raw material and product that are in balance by utilizing online media that is accessible to align in according with a right market segment. And besides that, to be paid to client lines, hygienist, yeah, part of the function of products. Jadi ketika pemasaran dalam kondisi COVID-19, maka yang pertama adalah dilakukan secara online. Namun memang kondisi Indonesia bagaimana dengan keterbatasan pada bahan baku, keterbatasan ketika media untuk penyampaian. Nah ini memang sekarang gitu ya, pemerintah sudah berusaha untuk memfasilitasi, utamanya dalam tanda petik gitu ya, untuk kebutuhan pokok, maka fasilitas-fasilitas itu sudah ada ya. Kalau di pertanian ada toko tani, tani hub dan lain-lain, dan semuanya adalah mengoptimalkan jaringan internet yang ada untuk proses pemasaran ini. Memang tidak mudah karena memang ini adalah kondisi yang saya katakan eksiden yang cukup parah gitu, apalagi pada daerah-daerah tertentu. Namun produser maupun pengusaha-pengusaha harus mau tidak mau menyesuaikan dengan kondisi ini. Ada juga Ibu Kapus, mohon izin dari chatting ada yang menanyakan terkait dengan, nah, penyuluh mau sebenarnya mengupdate diri, Bu. Ini terkait dengan di badan kita, di badan penyuluhan kita. Namun balai penyuluhan tidak memfasilitasi, pertanyaan seperti itu dari Pak Heri Bahya Tanjung, ya. Nah, ini sebenarnya pada pendahuluan sudah disampaikan sama Bapak Kepala Badan tadi bahwa akan ada program Kostatani. Sebenarnya Bapak pada program Kostatani di tahun ini sebenarnya sudah ada sekitar 3.800 sekian BPP yang akan difasilitasi dengan teknologi, dengan internet gitu ya. Namun dengan adanya COVID-19 ini maka anggaran yang ada sementara begitu ya dialihkan untuk penanggulangan ini, sehingga ini Bu Kapus juga bisa menambahkan ini ya, sehingga sedikit sekali yang bisa terfasilitasi pada tahun ini. Mudah-mudahan di tahun 2021 itu bisa ditindaklanjuti lagi. Satu lagi apa yang tadi ya?
Yang dari Pak Wahyu. Wahyudi.
Dr. Wahyudi terkait apa ya? Bisa diulang, Bu ya?
Model to solve the problems of the loose generation and young people.
Oh, baik. Jadi terkait dengan regenerasi petani ya, yang tadi sekilas kami sampaikan Pak Tri Wahyudi ya. Saya tadi sampaikan ini adalah suatu keharusan gitu ya, karena siapa lagi penggantinya ketika bukan generasi muda kita. Bagaimana untuk meningkatkan minat generasi muda untuk terjun di bidang pertanian? Maka satu kuncinya, generasi muda tidak mau terjun ketika tidak ada teknologi, inovasi tidak masuk. Oleh karena itu, inovasi harus diterapkan oleh pemuda-pemuda kita. Sehingga image mengenai pertanian itu kotor, miskin, itu nanti bisa beralih ke situ. Nah, kemudian yang kedua adalah, yang paling penting adalah bagaimana supaya jejaring usaha itu dijalin sebaik mungkin. Baik dari agro inputnya maupun nanti proses ya pada on farmnya maupun agro outputnya. Nah, sebenarnya ketika kegiatan-kegiatan di Kementerian Pertanian banyak sekali, misalnya Sapa Petani segala itu selalu melibatkan contoh-contoh pemuda-pemuda yang berhasil di sebagai pengusaha pertanian. Success story selalu ditampilkan sebenarnya untuk menggugah pemuda-pemuda kita bahwa terjun di dunia pertanian pun bisa. Nah, ini adalah pembelajaran yang harus terus kita gaungkan ya. Dalam tanda petik kita adalah negara agraris ya. Tentu keunggulan dari demografi, keunggulan dari topografi, keunggulan dari kesuburan tanah kita bisa kita optimalkan, dan ini adalah penerusnya adalah generasi muda kita. Saya rasa itu Bu Ida, terima kasih.
Thank you Pak Direktur, Pak Bambang Sudarmanto for your answer. I think Pak Tri, Pak Heri already clear with the question. So for the next question is for Pak Wahyu Sutisna, silakan Pak Wahyu. Tadi ada beberapa pertanyaan, there are some question from Pak Langgeng, and also there's a question from Pak Bayu Aryawan in the chat room that asking about the curriculum development, is that appropriate, and also considering as non-formal education system. So, your answer please, Pak Wahyu Sutisna. Pak Wahyu, can you unmute your voice? Pak Wahyu, we cannot hear you.
Now, did you hear me?
Okay, yeah.
So, the curriculum is defined by locally need, actually. It depends on the subject that will be learned. It depends on the subject matter that will be discussed throughout the season, actually. So, for example, if we are talking the rice crop or paddy, there will be a certain cycle from transplanting up to harvesting. Then, how do we learn about the first cycle or vegetative cycle without curriculum? So curriculum actually will be talking about the how do we apply knowledge for this cycle to be allowing farmers mastering in the technical aspect of that specific stages. So the curriculum is defined technical, actually the technical guidance is the curriculum from beginning to the end. So this is the why the curriculum have to be generated locally based on the need. The other example is for lion chicken. So from the barely old chicken until to the eggs. So the curriculum will follow the growth stages of the chicken from the early chicken until to the egg stages. So this is the curriculum actually we are talking about. So learning step, how to learn about the specific situation that could be lead us into the better understanding, and then farmer become per se the technical aspect of each stages that could be. Thank you, that one.
Okay, thank you. I think Pak Langgeng and also Pak Bayu Aryawan already agreed with Pak Wayan Sutisna, ya. So, Bu Novi, how about Professor Kumar? Because there are many, some question for him.
Yes, Mr. Kumar still there or no, or not, please?
Okay, maybe I will read the question from Media Agus Kurniawan. That asking about of the challenges on implementing the digital technology to the rural farmers, for Professor Kumar. And then also from Winianti, the question about maybe Professor Kumar can share also the experiences, how to motivate farmers who lives in the remote areas. And then usually the remote, the people in the remote areas have a very local tradition and also loyal to their local wisdom. So maybe Professor Kumar also can share his experience. But I think Professor Kumar...
There is not there. No. Yes, I think there is no Mr. Kumar again in this forum. Maybe we can write the write again all of the question and then we'll send the answer to by email, maybe, Miss.
Okay, yeah. We'll manage the question for Professor Kumar, and then answer to the participant, Bu Novia.
Yes, yes.
Okay. If there are no any question anymore, maybe we can finish our international webinar.
Yes. Okay.
I think, gentlemen, we are already come up to the end of the discussion, the end of the international webinar. Held by Polbangtan Malang, and it was a very interesting topic that we discussed, and also we have a very fruitful discussion. We could also lift up and increase our knowledge on agriculture extension, particularly for all of the participants who are working in terms of agriculture extension. And after this, hopefully, we could also share, we could also practice this new knowledge to the field. Yeah, maybe something about Farmer Feed School from Pak, new method from Ibu Aziza, and also the new idea or experience from Pak Bambang Sudarmanto and also Professor Kumar. The countries can also applied in the field by us, and for sure, in some cases, because we are a very different case, and then we have to solve also by locally, something like that. So thank you once again for all of the speakers here, Pak Profesor Kumar, Pak Bambang Sudarmanto, Bu Siti Aziza, and also for Pak Wahyu Sutisna for your presentation. And also I would like to thank to the all of the participants and also staff from Polbangtan Malang for organizing this international webinar. It's very interesting and useful for all of the participants. And also see you again in the international webinar of Badan Penyuluhan dan Pengembangan Sumber Daya Manusia Pertanian. Maybe the fourth in the next month. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I give time back to Ibu Novi. Silahkan, Bu Novi.
Yes, thank you, Miss Ida Widiarsanti. Thank you for the speaker also. And then, alhamdulillah, this international seminar is over, and I, as a host, I apologize if there are any words and something goes wrong. And before we closing off this seminar, maybe the maybe Panitia will be give the information about the result of the polling. Please, Ms. Nurlaili, maybe you can share about the result of the polling.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. Maybe if the participant not yet to fill of the polling can fill again, and then yeah. After that, Panitia will be share the result of the polling. What time for fill the bell? Fill is more likely.
We have 5 minutes, miss.
5 minutes more. Okay. Yes.
Untuk peserta yang sudah mengisi, mungkin tidak perlu mengisi lagi. Itu all participants who have filled our polling, you don't need to fill it again.
Unopi?
Yes, sir.
I can catch the meaning of questionnaire.
You will, pardon, who is talk? Can you raise hand, sir? Excuse me? You can repeat again, sir. How, Miss Lily? It is still enough? Hello, Miss Lily.
Yes, ma'am.
It is finished?
Not yet.
Not yet.
3 minutes left. Or 2 minutes left, sorry.
Okay. Okay, how?
1 minute left.
Yes. After that, maybe you can show about the result of polling.
Yes, yes, of course.
Okay, I think the time is over now. It's already 5 minutes. Waktu udah selesai.
Yes, and then how about the result?
Okay. Okay, jadi berdasarkan hasil poli, untuk media penyuluhan yang menurut Bapak Ibu paling cocok dilakukan pada saat pandemi COVID-19 itu adalah melalui sosial media. Kemudian untuk metode penyuluhan yang juga paling cocok untuk dilaksanakan di masa pandemi COVID ini adalah pertemuan tidak langsung atau indirect meeting. Dan materi penyuluhan yang baiknya lebih sering disampaikan pada saat pandemi COVID-19 ini adalah materi tentang marketing atau tentang pemasaran.
Okay, thank you, Miss Lily. I repeat again about the sharing about the order. Okay, close. Okay, thank you. Yes, thank you, Miss Lily, and thank you for all of the participants, specialized for the speaker and Miss Ida Widya Arsanti for your time. And then I will close for this seminar. And we once again, I apologize if there is something wrong. And then see you later. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih semuanya Bapak Ibu atas kehadirannya Bu Kapus. Specialized thank you for you Bu Kapus.
Oke.
Terima kasih Pak Wan. Bye.
Salam dari Aceh, di Stanbun, Aceh.
Terima kasih dari Aceh.
Thank you.
Pak Langgeng.
Halo nih.
Mas Langgeng, ya, terima kasih.
Terima kasih ya.
Selanjutnya dari Kapuas. Yes, semoga sukses kuliahnya.
Amin. Mendoanya.
Ya.
Masukan malam Minggu diadakan ngobrol penyuluhan mungkin lebih baik kayak Kementerian Desa, Ibu.
Ya gitu. Ya. Mudah-mudahan kita bisa share ya.
Siap.
Mas Agus. Iya, Profesor.
Mas Pak Langgeng ini alumni Pak Dir.
Masih.
Oh iya iya. Oh, iya.
Salam kenal Pak Direktur.
Sukses Mas Langgeng.
Alhamdulillah.
Matur nuwun Pak Budi Andara, matur nuwun Prof Budi.
Nggih, yeah, makasih Pak Bapak.
Prof Budi, matur nuwun.
Makasih. Pak Wahyu Stesna.
Terima kasih banyak.
Terima kasih.
Ibu Aziza juga terima kasih.
Lalu. Terima kasih.
Sampai ketemu
semuanya.
Masih monitor.
Masih monitor, Prof.
Alhamdulillah, sampai selesai.
Prof Budi lagi temu kangen dengan bimbingannya, Prof.
Itu udah ambil,
Prof. Mbak Lili, Prof.
Mbak Lili.
Bu Novi.
Ya, ya. Dalam.
Selamat siang, atau sore.
Iya, gimana apa kabar?
Selamat sore.
Sore. Gak kelihatan wajahnya.
Sembunyi.
Sembunyi wajahnya, jadi gak kelihatan. Terima kasih semuanya, ya Allah, alhamdulillah.
Ini sudah foto belum ini tadi?
Oh iya, foto bersama.
Sudah oh iya, belum difoto, nah, Abah. Jangan foto dulu, Abah, foto dulu. Di foto dulu, Mas.
Oh, di foto,
masih ada Prof Budi.
Foto.
Pak Wahyu tadi udah tidak ya?
Nah. Rica, terima kasih. Kenapa, Bu?
Di-mute.
Semua?
Anaknya mana?
Hah?
Oh, di TIK, Pak. Di TIK bisa diambil.
Di foto.
Kita foto kenang dulu, Mas Andi. Ada Prof. Kupo, masih ada Prof. Kupo.
Oh iya, sebentar, Bu.
mama. Mama, papa.
Alhamdulillah luar biasa pesertanya dari berbagai belahan dunia, Prof. Budi.
Nana.
Nah.
Silakan difoto Pak Andi.
Hai kalau difoto Pak Andi. Takut ditanya nggak aktif di persepsi.
Andi.
Ya, Mbah.
Sudah foto.
Sudah, Mbah.
Sudah ya.
Mana foto saya?
Oh, Abah di mana nggak ada ini?
Di halaman berikutnya sudah, Pak Andi.
Oh, belum, belum.
Di foto halaman berikutnya itu masih ada 4 sheet, alhamdulillah.
Monggo di videonya bisa dimunculkan. Videonya
mungkin bisa diaktifkan Bapak Ibu kita foto bersama.
Yang penting makan bersama Kang Andi.
Oh siap.
Kita foto makan bersama lewat.
Siap, siap.
Makan bersama di Jogja.
Silahkan ke Trenggalek Bapak Ibu semua.
Baik ya, Pak Amtiwul ya.
Oke, makasih.
Siap.
Pak Amtiwul.
Pak Direktur, saya dulu juga keluarga Kementan Badan SDM, Pak Direktur.
Oh, begitu? Oh
iya, iya, iya. Tahun 2008 sampai 2013.
Di mana? Di pusat apa?
Saya di Balai BBBKA Cinagara Bogor.
Oh, Cinagara. Ya, ya, ya. Ya, ya, ya.
Sekarang sudah ke Kabupaten Trenggalek.
Sudah semua, Mas Adi?
Sudah, ya. Yeah.
Ya, alhamdulillah semuanya ya, pamit ya. Terima kasih
Pak Budi. Aku semua pamit sekalian.
Terima kasih semuanya.
Jangan tanya makan, saya belum makan Bu Novi.
Oh iya, Bah. Belum sempat makan siang. Nanti disiapkan Mas Andi itu.
Ah, Kang Andi nyiapkan virtual aja kok. Makan virtual dia.
Iya. Bisa ditutup Mas Andi. Apa kita nanti makan-makannya tunggu Mas Andi ya.
Salam buat guru dosen Bapak Ismu.
Ya, terima kasih Mas Langgeng. Itu ada Pak Ismu, ada Pak Bambang.
Pak Bambang, Ibu Satrika.
Ya, ada apa? Ada Bu Satrika. Pak Richard sama Amahor. Oh, masih ada Bu dosen saya, Bu Aris.
Hai.
Aris ternyata.
Saya masih di Jogja.
Jogja Putih, Pak.
Jogja fotonya maksudnya apa ya?
Oh, Prof. Kumar, you still there? Itu Prof. Virendra Kumar masih ada, tapi
suaranya sudah nggak ada.
Oh, ya, sudah.
Halo, Pak Richard.
Para pesertanya Bu, tolong difoto semua Bu. Habis itu disiapkan.
Oh, Pak Richard minta difoto ya. Mas Adi sudah difoto tadi kan?
Tadi pas ngantuk saya foto dia. Bisa,
Bu, difoto. Habis itu tolong di-sharekan.
Sudah difoto belum Mas Adi? Di-share.
Pak Richard mulai ngantuk udah saya foto.
Ada alumni juga tuh, Bu Rika Jayanti Malik, selamat datang tuh.
Oh iya, Mbak Rika, mana Mbak Rika Jayanti?
Itu tuh ada tuh, masih ada.
Terima
sudah
kasih,
di,
Pak
Ibu. Sudah difoto, sudah disimpan, di share di grup panitia, Bu.
Oh iya, oke, okay, thank you. Ya,
ada Bu Rika, ada Bu Efta, Bu Ida. Pak Richard, sehat Pak Richard?
Sehat.
Oh iya, Pak Richard, ya.
Ketemu semua Pak Richard.
Senang bisa melihat senyum Bapak Ibu dosen.
Oh, ini Pak Wilson. Ini ada Pak Wilson, Bapak Ibu. Pak Wilson dari Universitas Palangkaraya, teman saya di Universitas UNS.
Salam kenal Pak Wilson.
Sama-sama, ya. Ya. Itu ada Ibu Satlikah, ada Mbak Witri, itu teman saya di situ.
Seangkatan.
Ya, dari Rika, sehat Rika.
Terima kasih Mbak Wilson.
Alhamdulillah Bu Novi.
Sukses. Kapan-kapan diundang di Palangkaraya.
Pamit lab ya.
Iya, yeah, Pak.
Iya, yeah, monggo nggih. Yeah.
Terima kasih.
Ya, silakan yeah. Bapak. Saya masih setia melihat Bapak Ibu.
Iya.
Saya
percaya. Oh iya.
Kita tetap seperti yang dulu.
Rika sekarang tinggal di mana?
Mau seminar hasil.
Amin. Oh, iya. Ya Allah, mohon doanya.
Mudah-mudahan. Alhamdulillah. Ya. Tinggal lanjutnya Rika ya. Mudah-mudahan ya sukses.
Mas Langgeng. Mas Langgeng dimana? Dimana sekarang Mas?
Trenggalek, Bu. Trenggalek.
Saya sekarang di Trenggalek, Ibu. Saya sudah 3 kali mutasi, Bapeda, PMD.
Bapeda sekarang di?
Sekarang di industri, baru saja.
Oh, barusan, ya.
Ya.
Mau kuliah lagi, Pak.
Mohon doanya.
Ya, ya, ya.
Amin, sukses.
Ya, lancar semuanya, sukses.
Amin.
Ya.
Oke. Okay. Saya punya kenangan sama Mas Langgeng. Pernah tak suruh berdiri di depan rumah ya, enggak boleh masuk ya, Mas.
Iya, Teh Bu Novi.
Di rumah saya enggak ada bapak, jadi Mas Langgeng nunggu di depan rumahnya Pak.
Oh Haji, iya, bapak. Waktu anu, Bu. Konsultasi ya, Bu.
Konsultasi.
Iya, Bu.
Alhamdulillah.
Oh iya. Kemarin juga banyak yang merespon juga mengenai telur jelly egg itu banyak yang...
Oh iya, thousand jelly eggs ya.
Iya.
Ya, Alhamdulillah. Manfaat ilmunya ya.
Ya, amin.
Oke, oke. Saya izin leave dulu. Mohon maaf, Bapak Ibu.
Guru-guru semua, saya
leave. Salam buat semuanya. Assalamualaikum.
Assalamualaikum.
Assalamualaikum. Terima kasih semuanya. Kami tutup.
Pak Sandi.
Mas Langgeng, matur nuwun.
Salam pripun nggih?
Kak Andi.
Apa itu?
Ya.
Iki
Amerika gimana?
Apa? Share link-nya materi enggak ada
nanti,
ya?
Belum. Nanti langsung sekalian masuk ke email dengan sertifikat.
Oh. Terima kasih.
Siap, sama-sama. Makasih banyak semuanya.